Well, Genesis chapter 6, title for today's message, nothing super fancy or anything, just an introduction to Noah's part in our story. Our story, meaning the story that belongs to us, the story that God wants us to know about how we got here in this place, this point in human history, in redemptive history. And when we think of God's work with humanity, God's interaction with humanity, Noah is one of the primary people in that story through history. He's one of the most significant people. And we turn our attention today to Noah's part in our story. Just by way of introduction, to let you know, some of you ask me these things fairly regularly. There are probably 5 messages on the flood account, maybe 6, depends on how these next couple weeks go, but probably 5 messages on the flood. By way of an outline for today, I just plan to kind of give something of an introduction to this section, and then remind you again briefly about these toldot sections, these section headings that Moses uses, and then to ask basically 2 questions. First of all, why raise this issue about what becomes of Noah? Why even talk about it? At this point, you get the end of chapter, or the beginning part of chapter 6, why begin to talk about Noah? And we'll talk about that some. And then secondly, why tell us this story in such a protracted and drawn out way? Remember, you know, so far in Genesis, we've covered lots of ground, lots of time in a few short chapters. It's taken us a while to do it, right? But there's a lot compacted in that, a lot of time compacted in those chapters. And then here now we get 4 chapters, basically about 1 year of time. And why tell it in that way? And so we'll kind of ask and attempt to answer that question as well. So with that, let's pray and ask for God's help in this today. Father in heaven, we thank you for another chance to come together as a body and hear your word, have it taught, to have a time focused here where we're listening to what has been gleaned from your word, from others. We're asking for you to make clear to us what's here in the text, to give us the sense, to fix our mind more on you as it ought to be, help us see things we've not seen before. Help us in this. Help me as I teach to convey to others what you've given to me. Help it, Lord, to cause it to sink in and to settle in and bear fruit in the years to come. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. The first thing I want to do is maybe it might strike you immediately as a bit of trivia, but I trust by the time we're done, or maybe even halfway done through the message, you'll see why it's significant. And I don't want to bring it out later because it kind of really disrupts things. So I'll just bring it out now. And that is that this flood account, the account of the flood itself, starting in Genesis chapter 6 and verse 11, "Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence. And God saw that the earth... God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, 'I have determined to make an end of all flesh, for the earth is filled with violence through them. Behold, I will destroy them with the earth.'" The actual flood account, all the way down to chapter 8 and verse 8, verse 22, where God then says, so we begin, God says, he looks at the earth and the corruption of it and says, I'm going to flood the earth. I'm going to destroy man. I'm going to destroy the earth with him. Now in chapter 8, look at this, verse 21. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man, for the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I ever again strike down every living creature as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. So the flood account begins with God seeing the corruption and the wickedness of man and determining to destroy the whole earth as a result of it. And it ends with God still considering the corruption of man, but saying, but never again will I destroy the earth in this way. So you see how it ends or begins and ends kind of on the same topic, right? Well, I want you to see that the whole story of the flood is told in this parallel fashion, what's called a chiasmus. It's like you start out with God looking at the wickedness of man and saying, I'm going to destroy the earth. It ends with God looking at the wickedness of man and saying, I will not destroy the earth. And then the next level, it begins. Noah builds an ark as directed. That's the next thing. What's the thing at the end of the story? Right before God says, I'll never do this. Noah builds not an ark, but an altar and makes sacrifices to God and does what's pleasing to the Lord. So Noah builds an ark. Noah builds an altar. Now the next level, the Lord commands them to enter. What was the thing that happened immediately before Noah built the ark? God commanded them to exit. Okay, after he told them to enter, what happens? The flood begins. And right before God told them to exit, the earth dries. After the flood began, what happened? Well, we're told explicitly, the flood prevails 150 days and the mountains are covered. Okay, well, what happened right before the flood ended on the other side? Well, the flood receded for 150 days after the mountains were made visible. You see this, it's quite a thing, or the mountains were made visible. In between, in the middle, so we kept going, stair-stepping back into the story. Now we're at the point where there's just one thing in the middle, and what is it? Genesis chapter 8 and verse 1, the first half. But God remembered Noah and all the beasts and all the livestock that were with him in the ark. That's the central thing. That's the hinge upon which this whole story turns. So if you're thinking about how to tell the story of the flood, you just got to remember these steps, right? God considers the wickedness of humanity and determines to destroy the earth. Tells Noah to build something, the ark. Then God commands them to enter. The flood begins. The flood prevails for 150 years and the mountains are covered. Then God remembers Noah. And then you just got to walk the steps back. Then the waters began to God caused the wind to blow and the waters began to recede on the earth for 150 days and the mountaintops were visible. Right? We're talking about the general storyline here. The mountaintops were visible. And then the earth eventually dried out completely such that they could exit. God commanded them to leave the ark. Then Noah builds an altar to God. God's pleased with that and God determines never again to destroy the earth in the way he did, despite the corruption of man. And that's the story. But the hinge is God remembers Noah. God remembers Noah. Now, again, that might strike you immediately as trivia, but it's significant, and it will come out again here later as we talk more today. Now, the next thing I want to do is just to remind you of these toldot sections. Again, just a Hebrew word here. What are these sections? Well, they are, again, these are the generations of, and that means basically, this is what became of, this is what came from this person, this is their part in the story, this is how, he picks a topic, whether it's the heavens and the earth, or whether it's Adam, or whether it's Noah, or whether it's Terah later, or whoever it may be, we're looking at what came from them. This is kind of a turning point, and we're setting off in a new trajectory, and we're going to talk about what came from this person or these circumstances, what happened there. And they are in themselves sections. What have we seen so far concerning these told out sections? Well, we started out, Moses began his book with this creation account, these 7 days of creation. He told us that. And then the question was, well, what became of that? And that was his agenda in Genesis chapters 2, 3, and 4, to explain what happened to the heavens and the earth as the Lord God made them. As they left his hand, as things were so incredibly wonderful, what happened? How do things get to be the way they are? And he answers that, specifically about the fall and the corruption of humanity and the curse upon the world. And that's his answer. It's basically humanity turned their backs to God and sought to live on this earth apart from God and make their own way, though there were some who had begun to call upon the name of God. Then we come to the next thing. Okay, well, if that's what happened, then tell me more about that. What happened then to humanity in general? What happened to the descendants of Adam? What happened to Adam and his race? And we read that they all were corrupted like Adam, and Adam, though he fell into sin and became something in some ways different, what happened? He had children after his own image, in his own likeness, still in the image of God, yes, but also very much corrupted and like him. And in that context, going on for thousands of years, there were some men who, maybe others, who lived an exceptionally long life, and some of these particularly had walked with God. We're told that explicitly. And had sought God and looked to God for deliverance. But they were few. In general, humanity's sin increased and got worse and worse. It got so bad that we don't even quite understand exactly what was going on, but something terrible was going on that was an absolute defiance to God. And in one sense, you might say, push God to the brink. God says in verse 3 of Genesis chapter 6, then the Lord God said, my spirit shall not abide or contend with man forever, for he is flesh, and his days shall be 120 years. So God makes a determination. He's going to bring judgment and destroy humanity. Verse 5, the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out man whom I have created from the face of the land, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them. And if we stop there, you just think, well, that's the end of the story, I guess. There's nothing left for humanity. There's nothing left for the earth. God's just going to abort his entire enterprise here. It's just over. All of his efforts to no use, to no end, just wipe it all clean again. But we read before this section is over, when we're talking about what became of man, what we're reading about right now is up until this point, what became of man is he's about to just be destroyed and forgotten on the face of the earth. That's what became of Adam. For all the righteous descendants that he had, and we're told about some, it's all over. God's judgment on the collective group of humanity is to destroy them off the face of the earth. And not just them, so I will blot out man whom I have created from the face of the land, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens. Everything you know about, everything in which is the breath of life, all the creatures, God's going to destroy all of it. What a thing. We ought not think, well, it's just that God's angry with men, and so men are going to suffer. When God made man, he made man to have dominion and to inhabit a certain earth and to have dominion over certain creatures, and there was a whole way of interacting that God had intended. That was a plan, a purpose that satisfied God when he saw it, that God wanted to inhabit and to dwell in the midst of, that pleased God. And man, it says, has corrupted the whole thing. He's ruined it all. And it's such an offense and an affront to God. Not just that man messed up the good plan that God had, but man himself is such an affront to God, so defiant toward God, so repulsive to God in his sin, that God's determined he's going to destroy humanity. But, verse 8, Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. And so they're like, well, what happens? Tell me about him. What do you mean he found favor? I mean, it doesn't sound like anybody is having favor with God. God's not favorably disposed to any human being. But to Noah, he is. So tell me about Noah. And so this, we just launch off in this direction. What is it Noah is able to do to save the story? I mean, how does Noah change all this? Because it's over for us. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. So tell me about him. And so we begin to go back into the life of Noah and begin to tell the story about Noah and about what happened and what it meant that he found favor with God and how that's significant and important for all of us. So the purpose of this toldot section then, this section that goes all the way to the end of chapter 9, is to answer an issue, to teach us something important. It functions as a unit. We can subdivide it in some ways, but essentially there's a certain theme. We're driving the story forward to a certain end. Moses wants to tell us this story and tell us the story in all the details that he gives us so that we're to the end of it, we have a certain understanding about the condition of the world and the way God and humanity move forward together. That's the point. So then, these two big questions I want to address. Why raise this issue about what became of Noah? Why raise this issue? First of all, because Noah bears the hopes of his father that perhaps Noah will bring men relief, quote, from our work and from the painful toil of our hands. Let's go back into chapter 5 and consider this for a second. Verse 28, when Lamech had lived 182 years, he fathered a son and called his name Noah, saying, out of the ground that the Lord has cursed, this one shall bring us relief from our work and from the painful toil of our hands. So Noah bears those hopes. And we have seen others in Genesis so far upon whom those hopes were placed, that this one will bring us rest, this one will bring us back, this one will fix everything. And it just never quite worked out. In fact, nothing really happened in any of those men's lives. I mean, not that nothing happened. I mean, Cain murdered his brother, that's something. And he went out and built a city and disobeyed God and tried to build a kingdom, an anti-God kingdom in a sense. That's significant, but that's not anything toward the redemption that we're seeking, or maybe we could say the reconciliation that we're seeking with God. That's nothing toward giving us these hopes. Abel, by the time you realized Abel might have been able to do something in terms of the eyes of his parents, he was dead. So he never got us anywhere either. Seth, well, he realizes he himself is weak and humanity is nothing but weakness. He names his son Weakness. And finally, people begin to say, God, we got to look to God if anything's ever going to happen. And then eventually, someone in there looking to God sees something about this boy and names him Noah and says, perhaps this one, right? Out of the ground that the Lord has cursed, this one shall bring us relief from our work and from the painful toil of our hands. And I want to say a couple things about this. First of all, in one sense, Noah doesn't do this at all. If you think the flood is the story about rescuing humanity from their painful toil and from the hard work of the ground, you've missed it. That is not what the flood is about. It's not about we're going to make life. Life has been really hard. So what we're going to do, see, is we're going to kill everything so that you guys can have oil or something. Like it's not, that's not the idea. It's not to make life easier for us. That's not the story. So just get that out of your mind. It's not, well, Noah is the one who provided us with this. Not at all. The flood does not provide man with relief, but with destruction and with judgment. Rather, it provides relief to God. The flood provides relief to God, not to man. It's not the painful toil of man, but the heartfelt grieving of God that finds relief in the flood. Think of this. Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out man. I mean, this is God's response to God's emotion, to God's perception, to God's experience. It does not say, and the Lord God saw that the toil of man was great upon the earth and difficult and painful, and so the Lord God decided to blot out man. That's not what we read. It's not God's observation about our difficulty that he's caused us that he repents of. It's rather God seeing his own difficulty that we've caused him, that causes him, in a sense, to repent, to be sorry, to think differently about what he'd done. In a sense, if words have meaning, in some sense, to change his mind. Right? What a thing. Don't accuse me of false teaching there, right? But you understand. This is what the text presents us with this. He was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. We'll look at all these things in greater detail later. Now, in another sense, in terms of Noah bringing relief, if it were not for the grace of God found by Noah, there would have been no eventual fulfillment of man's return to God's rest in the earth. Think about that. I mean, that's one of the promises that was made, right? That some seed was going to come and make things right, and bring us back and overthrow the work of the devil and crush him and conquer him and be victorious. And all the schemes of the devil would be undone and overthrown through a man. And Lamech here is, look, Noah's father saying, maybe this is the one. This will be the one to bring us deliverance. Well, we can say this. Had Noah not found favor in the eyes of God, those promises would have been empty, unfulfilled, impossible. If God didn't set his favor upon Noah and save him and rescue him and deliver him from the destruction that he brought upon humanity, there would have been no humanity left. There would have been no God in his habitation with man, pleased with his creation, worshipped by his creation for all eternity. We wouldn't know the love of God, the redemption of Christ. None of that would be known. God wouldn't have displayed himself as he intends. We wouldn't have the rest that we have in Christ. Now, this deliverance, this rest that we've come to know in Christ did not come immediately through Noah or directly through Noah, but rather through an eventual descendant. We need to realize that it was through Noah that we are alive today. It's pretty sobering to think that all the world perished but eight people, and those eight survived only on the basis of Noah having found grace with God. It doesn't say anything about Noah's sons finding grace with God, or his wife, or his daughters-in-law. It says that Noah found grace. Now, in another sense, still, insofar as Noah was a righteous man, God did provide relief for mankind through the flood. This is a very minor point, but it's true. Think of this. Man is delivered not from his painful toil, not from what Lamech thought, oh, all the relief from our painful toil, but rather from the runaway flood of his own evils. Humanity is delivered from the runaway flood of his own evils. He had corrupted the earth and corrupted his way upon the earth. And the earth was corrupt because of him, ruined. And God washed all that away and began anew, in a sense, began afresh, restarted the original plan. What a blessing. I mean, have you ever done something and just, you had a plan to do one thing and you just really messed it up? And you think, and you got to start over because you've made such a mess of the thing you're trying to do that you could never salvage it now. You could never fix it now. In a sense, humanity gets that with Noah. We've made such a wreck of the earth. God wipes it all clean and we start afresh. Now, we're still who we are, but we kind of begin afresh. And in that sense, man is delivered not from his painful toil, but from the runaway flood of his own evils. Through the washing of the world, God washed away the evil and the sin of men. They had corrupted and ruined the earth, and now the earth would ruin them and start afresh towards God's original purposes once again. Just one text for this for you to see it, because this is the one that, I mean, it's kind of more argumentation rather than looking directly at text. And I can show you this text and prove the point from 2 Peter chapter 2. There's a point in this in 2 Peter where he is talking about false prophets and false teachers, and he begins to talk about the way that God can deliver us from such circumstances. And he says this, "For if God," verse 4, "for if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them into hell and committed them to chains of gloomy darkness to be kept until the judgment." So if God can do that, and then secondly, "if he did not spare the ancient world, but preserved Noah, a herald of righteousness, with seven others, when he brought a flood upon the world of ungodly." And then, if by turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes, he condemned them to extinction, making them an example of what is going to happen to the ungodly. And if, in that situation, he rescued righteous Lot, greatly distressed by the sensual conduct of the wicked. Verse 9, "then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from trials." So you have these examples. He's wanting to prove that God can rescue the ungodly or the godly from, he can rescue the godly from trials, and he can keep the unrighteous under punishment until the day of judgment, especially those who indulge in the lust of defiling passion, and especially those who despise authority. So he gives some examples in history where the godly have been rescued from the ungodly, those that were ungodly around them. And he mentions specifically by name Noah. He says, "if he did not spare the ancient world, but preserved Noah, a herald of righteousness with seven others, when he brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly." Well, if he knows how to do that, then you know by example, by previous action, that he does in fact know how to rescue the godly from trials. So when you think about Noah, one of the things you need to be thinking about, here's a godly man, a righteous man, and his life's experience is one of trial and difficulty and being vexed by the ungodliness around him. And in a sense, he's delivered from that through the flood. God rescued him. Or to emphasize it another way, you might say, Noah was just a man. And as a man, he was kin with all the other men, and humanity deserves judgment and condemnation and be wiped off the face of the earth. But Noah in and himself was a godly man. And God is able to distinguish the godly from the ungodly. And when he brings this kind of a judgment upon all the world, God is more than able to single out the righteous ones and to deliver them. Sometimes he delivers just them. Other times, he delivers them and others with them on their account. But that's what happens. This is what God does. So, when we talk about this hope that was placed upon Noah, that he would be the one, Out of the ground that the Lord God has cursed, this one shall bring us relief from our work and from the painful toil of our hands. In one sense, he doesn't bring us relief from our work and the painful toil of our hands. He does bring a form of relief. God brings deliverance from just the decadence and the evil and the corruption that humanity has brought upon the world through their own actions. Noah's delivered from them. Just him and his family now. Start afresh. Sometimes you might feel that way. The world is so terrible. I just wish we could just start afresh with me and my wife and my children and just us. We could just, it'd be so much better. Now you might be mistaken if you think that way, but that's, you kind of get that chance. And Noah got that. He found favor with God. He was a righteous man. He walked with God, and God did that. In another sense, this, whatever we come to know about the rest that God has provided for us in Christ and what Lamech was hoping Noah would do does come through Noah long term, eventually. Right? Apart from the grace of God shown to Noah, Christ never comes. There's no seed of David because there's no David, and there's no David because there's no Israel, and there's no Israel because there's no Abraham, and there's no Abraham because there's no Terah because there's no Noah. Thank God for the grace he showed to Noah, and that Noah found that in his dealings with God. But in another sense, again, the greatest relief provided in the flood is relief to God. It's God's relief. God was the one who was vexed. You think man had it bad? You think man, every time he woke up and he looked upon his surroundings, he looked upon the earth, and he had to go through another day like this? You think he was in pain? The text shows us God was grieved down to his heart. However that's possible, surely we're to understand a great grief and pain and source of agony to the Lord God. That's why you raise the issue about what became of Noah. That's one reason. Why else? Well, because we're told that Noah found grace with God in a time when God had determined to blot out mankind on the face of the earth. That's significant. I mean, again, when I began going through those told-out sections and we left with, but Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord, we would say, well, what do you mean? We're living in a time where everyone's going to be condemned and this one found favor. What does that mean? Tell me how that works out. Fill me in. Now, as I try to explain this, what does it mean that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord? Let's first be real clear. We know that no one is sinless, right? We know that. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And we know that everyone, if God were to enact strict justice, deserves hell. Remember the words of Paul? He said that he was the chief of all sinners. But he also says that grace was shown to him because he had sinned in ignorance. You can be the chief of all sinners and at the same time have certain circumstances about your sinning that makes God less angry with you. It's amazing. I mean, he says, I was shown grace because I had sinned in ignorance. I didn't realize fully what I was doing. Which doesn't mean that my sins weren't sins. It just means they could have been worse. And to an outsider, they might have appeared worse. But for God, who knows my heart, they were gravely offensive, but not as bad as you might have thought that they were. That's all he means by that, essentially. God showed him grace because his sins were in ignorance. We know, again, that all men sin. And if God wanted, he could justly send us all to hell. And so with that in mind, many people look at this and says, Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. And they say, Noah had nothing to do with it. It was just the sovereign grace of God. And we know doctrinally that's true. Jacob I loved, Esau I hated. What makes the distinction and the difference between Noah and the rest of the world is God set his grace upon Noah. to make something of Noah, to preserve Noah from the flood of sin that all of his relatives were enjoying. So they thought. There's something about in the text here, perhaps, I'm not entirely convinced, but I've read it in quite a few commentaries. And they make the argument that when it says Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord, or found grace in the eyes of God, or Noah had grace from God, that the idea isn't that it just kind of, it's not punctiliar, it's not like he was going through life and just one day, boom, God just started showing him grace, but rather he was in this state of grace, right? In terms of Noah and his relationship with God, contrary to everyone else in their ongoing relationship with God, where they were under his wrath, which was soon to fall, Noah was in another situation where he was living his days under the grace of God. His experience with God was one of being under grace, not under wrath. That's very possible. Now, that said, let's not forget what the passage says about Noah. Verse 9, these are the generations of Noah. You want to know about Noah? Noah was a righteous man. He was a righteous man. Secondly, he was blameless in his generation. Thirdly, Noah walked with God. Now, it's told me that Noah is better than I am in three different ways, essentially, right? I mean, he's better than the average guy. Does that make sense? I mean, you think about yourself, apart from the grace of God in your life and what's become of you having become a Christian. Look at this. Here was Noah. He was a righteous man, blameless in his generation, walking with God. That's profound. That's not said about many people. He's the first person about whom all three of those things are said in the Bible. What a thing. He's commended three times by God in this text. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. Noah walked with God. The last person we're told who walked with God didn't even die at all. God just took him. Well, Noah walked with God. And he was blameless in his generation, and he was a righteous man. Don't forget about that. And surely, wouldn't we agree that if it was just that Noah had just found favor, that God just singled him out and said, "Well, I'm going to save this one." This text in verse 9 tells us that it's not just that God did that. He looked out and there was something different in Noah's life. He walked differently than the rest. He was unique. He was blameless in his generation. He was righteous. He walked with God. In a time, verse 11, the earth was corrupt in God's sight. Well, that's not what it just said about Noah. It said he walked with God. He was righteous and blameless. He wasn't corrupt. The earth was filled with violence, and God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, "I've determined to make an end of all flesh, for the earth is filled with violence through them. Behold, I will destroy them with the earth." Them. I'm going to destroy all of them, Noah. Look what they have done. He's singled out in this story. He stands apart in his generation. So we want to know what becomes of Noah, because he found grace. He stands out as unique in this time. Another reason to tell us what became of Noah is because Noah's life, you kind of have to know the end of the story, but Moses knows the story and he wants to tell the story. Why does he want to tell us the story? Why raise this issue? Because Noah's life proved to be, in some sense, a new start. Things changed dramatically from his birth to his death. I mean, everything that comes before, I mean, we're told elsewhere in Scripture that this things before the flood compared to after the flood are described as two different worlds. The world that then was and the world that now is. That's profound. That's in, I think it's 1 Peter, 1 or 2 Peter, I believe 1 Peter. Let me just read it real quick. So you see it. I'll just take my word for it. In 2 Peter, he says, for they deliberately overlooked this fact, that the heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and through water by the word of God, and that by means of these the world that then existed was deluged with water and perished. But by the same word, the heavens and earth that now exist are stored up for fire. It's like it's a different heavens and earth in some sense. Right? It's a fresh start is what we understand. It's not that everything's totally different, but it's a fresh start. What God established at the beginning, He reestablishes. Think about Noah walking off the ark and just what a profound sense of newness or of difference you would have. I mean, what a thing. Our food is different now. Right, we're to eat different things, however you understand that. The population is radically different. It's no longer Johnny down the street and his kids who are a real terror. It's just you and your children and your families. What a distinction. How many landmarks are different? Where things are, I mean, everything gets a new name, maybe. Lots of changes. Your knowledge of God. How different. I mean, I don't know what Noah's sons were thinking. They weren't commended as righteous. But I mean, here's Noah walking with God. Here's Noah who's blameless. Everyone else, nobody takes sin too seriously. But what do you do when you come off the ark? Your whole perspective's changed. Your view of God is different. Even which God, perhaps. It's a totally new start. Think about the first creation account. You had water covering everything. In the flood, water covers it all again. Then the dry land appears. And also in the flood story, the dry land appears. After it's all appeared and everything's there, everyone goes out onto the face of the earth, and God tells humanity something. Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Command it again. Food is provided for man. Before it was from every green plant you can eat, you and the animals. Now it's you can eat all that stuff, and just like I gave you that stuff, now I give you all the animals. Any animal that's there, eat it. It's yours. You see the similarities here, and there's a lot of them. And we'll cover some more of them later. But I want you to see that there's a new start that begins with Noah. And so it's important to tell us this story. Imagine the Bible if the story of Noah was just skipped. If it just went down this genealogy, and when we got to Noah and we got to his sons, it just kept going in the genealogy and picked up in chapter 10 where it continues. In one sense, I mean, you ought to ask yourself, what's missing? I mean, what matters to you about the flood story? Is there anything here? Could we just excise it out of our Bible and continue on in the genealogy and just get us to Abraham? We don't need to know anything about the flood. There are very important things that we're meant to understand here, which is why it's told. There's a new start. Noah had certain hopes placed upon him. It's important to flesh that out and explain how that does or doesn't happen and what relief was really needed in the world. God's relief, not man's. To explain about Noah's finding favor with God and to show how he began things anew and afresh. So then why tell the story in this long, protracted way? If we're going to tell it, why tell it in this way? We might say, I guess, if it's worth telling, it's worth telling right. If you're going to tell the story, make it do some work. Tell it in such a way that teaches us something, that teaches us the lessons we're supposed to learn and the things that Noah was supposed to learn And so Moses sets out to do that. Again, he covers 1 year in four chapters, 6, 7, 8, and 9. We got 1 year's period of time. There's nothing else like that. I mean, Genesis 3, you get one chapter, right? That's just the events of a day or a couple days. That's significant, but you just move right on. Cain and Abel. Cain gets half a chapter, a little more than that, but that's it. Here we get 1 year, and we got four chapters. So the reason why you tell it in this way is, I have three reasons. First of all, because there are important lessons to be learned about God, man, about God's purpose and way with mankind. We're meant to think differently about God. I mean, why do you think the story draws us in to show us how all this was affecting God and what God's response was then, and the way God provided for Noah, and the way God promised afterwards to humanity and to Noah and to all the earth? It's all about what God's doing and how God is posturing himself towards a rebellious humanity and teaching us about God's character. When you watch someone go through their day and go through difficult circumstances and go through things that upset them and anger them, and you see them and the way they respond, you learn a great deal about them. And we are meant not just to have our eyes upon Noah and him getting into the ark and the animals there, and to be thinking about that and trying to draw pictures about what it was like on the ark and what did it smell like and what did they eat and how did they sleep and where did they go and where's the ark now? That's immaterial. Get your eyes upon God and get your eyes upon the way He is towards humanity and what He says about Himself, what He will do and won't do. And look at Noah and the way he obeys God and walks with God and God delivers him. Consider these things. Remember the promises that God has already made and see the way He deals with the present impossibility of that ever happening by intervening in the world to make it come to pass one day. Learn about God. That's why we're given the details we're given. Why else? So that's one thing. There are important lessons to be learned about God, man, and God's purpose and way with mankind. Secondly, it's one of the most significant events in human history and in mankind's dealings with God. The flood. I mean, no one had any doubt or question that when we went to Genesis 1, we were dealing with things that are significant. Or Genesis 2 and 3, these are significant things. Huge things for us to understand. Well, wouldn't it also be important to know that one time, at one point, because sin really is that offensive to God, He did act the way we think that He ought to if He's as righteous as He is, though even in the midst of that, He was gracious and merciful and began again, almost hitting the restart button on His creation. It's huge. Of all the events in human history that you might leave out, this isn't one of them. This is huge. If you're writing a history of the world, the recreation, in a sense, of the world is massive. Massively important. One of the most significant events in human history. And we might say, and in religious history. Third, why should Moses tell the story in such a detailed and drawn-out way? And this one is very important and brings us back to something we have talked about long ago in this series. Because the story of this very significant event had been compromised through the perversion of man and false traditions that man had taught throughout the world. I'll say that again. Because the story of this very significant event and the truth of this story had been compromised and distorted and diluted and twisted through the perversion of man and man's own false traditions and his false religions and the things that he taught throughout the world. What do I mean? You may have heard people say, every ancient culture in the world has a flood story. And they do. I mean, if we've found artifacts from an ancient culture, we've found something about their about a flood story. It's significant. It's amazing. If they were able to write and preserve things, they've got a flood story. That's huge. So here are the Israelites, and they know about these flood stories. They hear them all the time. It's not the one that their granddad or their great-great-great-granddad told them, maybe, but they, I mean, everywhere they go, people have a different version and a different account. It all stems from the same true facts, the same true history, but they're twisted. And so God sets the record straight, and Moses sets the record straight for the people of Israel, to know truth from error. And here's why that's important. You might say, well, it's just one story. Those stories lie about God. And those stories lie about whether other gods exist. And those stories lie about humanity and the way God and man relate. They tell profound lies that, if believed, will cause you to turn away from God or to think wrongly about God and to not know God. And God determines to set the record straight. I want to read from a book from my library called Against the Gods. About a page and a half. If the biblical stories are true, we could say since the biblical stories are true, one would be surprised not to find some references to these truths in extra-biblical literature or in stories outside the Bible. And indeed, in ancient Near Eastern myth, we do see some kernels of historical truth. However, pagan authors vulgarized and bastardized those truths. They distorted fact by dressing it up with polytheism, magic, violence, and paganism. Fact became myth. From this angle, the common references, things that are common about both the biblical story and those other stories, would appear to support rather than deny the historicity of the biblical story. The Hebrew writers certainly would have been aware of and familiar with the pagan flood myths. Those accounts appear to have been ubiquitous or common in the ancient Near East. Not only did they not agree with those stories, however, but there is internal evidence in the biblical text that one angle to their writing the biblical narrative was to dispute and to impugn those other stories. This is the polemical or the argumentative wrinkle. As we have repeatedly seen in this study, the Genesis writer is a radical monotheist. He believes in one true God. His presentation of the flood account not only relays the event in a historical manner, it also contains harsh and radical rebukes of the pagan myths. These taunts toward the pagans are often subtle, but they are also purposeful. We can look at a few examples of this polemic. First, the entire biblical narrative accentuates the role of Yahweh in this episode. He is in full control of the events. Yahweh wills to destroy mankind. He determines to send a deluge. He saves Noah. He shuts Noah in the ark. He sends the flood and blots out all living creatures, and he causes the flood to subside. Yahweh governs the world. The sovereign control exercised by Yahweh over the floodwaters is in striking contrast to the reaction of the Mesopotamian gods in the Epic of Gilgamesh. Quote, "The gods were frightened by the deluge, and shrinking back, they ascended. They ran up to the heaven of Anu. The gods cowered like dogs crouched against the outer wall, fearful of the floods. The gods, all humbled, sit and weep." What a distinction, what a contrast. These pagan deities are at the mercy of nature, whereas Yahweh presides over nature with full command. In the Epic of Gilgamesh, Utnapishtim takes a much more active role than Noah. Utnapishtim made his family and other humans and animals go aboard the ship. He was also the one who battened up the entrance. In the earlier epic of Atrahasis, the flood hero is once again the one to seal the doorway of the ship. To the contrary, in the Genesis account, the animals are brought to Noah, and it is Yahweh who shuts them all in the ark. These points underscore the truth of the sovereignty of God and that the entire episode is unfolding according to his purpose and will. Yahweh, not man, is the primary actor in the story. In the Mesopotamian accounts, the hero of the flood offers sacrifices to the gods in the form of libations after he disembarks from the ship. The response of the gods is one of famished desire. The gods smelled the savor. The gods smelled the sweet savor. The gods gathered around the sacrifices like flies. In the biblical account, Noah's sacrifice is an act of worship that is for the atonement of his sin. Yahweh smelled the pleasing aroma of the sacrifice, and he swore that he would never destroy mankind again by a flood. That phrase is idiomatic. It simply means that the Lord accepted and delighted in Noah's sacrifice. Yahweh is not like the pagan gods who gather around the sacrifice like flies because of his huge hunger. And I'll stop there. You see the contrast and why it's necessary. With all these stories floating around and the way they impugn God and tell falsehoods about God and man and the history of what had happened, why it's necessary to tell this story in detail, to set the record straight, to tell the truth about what happened, so that we can, because if you believe the other stories about what happened, you'll think wrongly about God. Which tells me then that if Moses and God take aim to tell this story and set the record straight, there's something here for me to glean, to gain, to learn, to apply to my life, to take with me in the rest of the Bible. I ought to think a certain way about God here. So in terms of application, just a few things. As we prepare, or as we set out now to consider the results of Noah's life in these weeks ahead and of God's dealings with him, let's be ready and let's be willing to be reminded of the holiness of our God, the greatness of his promise, the reliability of his steadfast character. We see these things come out, and they're meant to strike us, to leave us with an impression. We ought to be amazed at the wrath of God when we see it unleashed from heaven. That ought to shock us. We ought to carry that with us. Jesus brings it up, right, when he's talking about what it's going to be like when judgment comes. Like in the days of Noah. That's what it's going to be like. People marrying and being given in marriage right up to the end. Some newly made bride won't have a wedding night because the wrath of God will come. Think of that. And maybe more than all of this, maybe more important than all of that, may we be struck again with God's concern for each and every individual person's individual holiness. I mean, Noah is singled out in the world. He himself was blameless. He was righteous. He walked with God. That's God's desire for every one of us. We ought not think that you can excuse yourself from that and escape judgment. God is greatly concerned with our own personal holiness and our own personal righteousness before him. Are we walking with God? Not sinlessly perfect, are we walking with God? Well, again, those things I hope will stay with us as we move through these chapters, as we talk about them, explain them, answer some questions that we have. Most importantly, learn about God and his dealings with man. Are there questions or comments anyone has on things that were shared here today?